In the beginning of the world, or a little later, I wasn't there yet quite. In the beginning of the world, there was the glass and the bottle. One day when Theoton with his sun chariot came too close to the earth, he dried up all the countries below him. The meadows had no grass. The avocados had no help. The rivers ran dry. Birds fell from the sky. Animals collapsed open-mouthed in the fields. Every effort went into protecting the holy water in the churches. Desperate for shade, people took refuge under the bellies of cows. And so, the people began to swell up. Some in the back. That's how the race began that descended from Aesepe the Phrygian, the one you've all read about in the pretty stories. Others swelled in the fingers of their hands, so that they looked like bagpipes. Others expanded lengthwise in the leg so that they looked like cranes or flamingos. Still others had noses that grew so big they looked like the spout of a distillery flask, glittering with sweat. Such was the nose of Father Tipplecup, and also the nose of Firefart, that freshwater doctor in the village of Angers. Others grew swollen ears that covered their waves, they covered their wives like a bullfighter's cape. Finally, there were some who inflated evenly, harmoniously, all over their bodies. And from them was born the race of the giants. The first of these was Harshtarsh Fork, who begat his Spinfrock, who ate his soup and reigned so well at the time of the flood that, sitting astride Noah's Ark, he steered it wherever he wanted to go with his feet. He begat Atlas, who used his shoulders to hold up the world. He begat No Bread For You, who begat Eleconario, who drank all the thirsts ever that there were, past, present, and future. Note, too, that he was the first one to play dice with spectacles. And he begat Hatch Befessa, who begat Gribeli, who begat Wolfware of the Hairy Thighs, who begat Boliverax, who begat Bric-a-Brac, who begat Faberdan de Cornam, who was vanquished by the Danish ogre. And he begat Colophoniac, who begat Flames Are Pretty Hot. And he was the one who made lip noises like a monkey when he picked apart his crayfish. He begat Cornabone, the skin of whose stomach hung remarkably far from his kidneys. And he begat Cloud, who begat Moo, who begat Luft, who begat Pook, who begat Grand Goussier, who begat my master, the noble giant Gargantua. and who was the most shocked and dumbfounded of all by the birth of Gargantua? Why, his father, Grangousier. Since his wife, Badebec, had died, Grangousier was confused about whether to cry for his spouse's death or to laugh at the birth of his son. Should I weep? Should I weep? He said, yes, for such a good wife is dead. She was this, she was that. It's an immeasurable loss. Oh God, God, what have I done for you to punish me this way? Why didn't you let me go first? To live without her is nothing but languishing. Oh, Badebec, my darling, my sweetheart, my radish root, my bedroom slipper, my quail egg. Oh, Badebec, I'll never see you again. And poor little Gargantua, you've lost that dearly beloved woman, your true mother, your sweet nurse. Saying this, he wept like a veal calf. But just as quickly, he started to belly laugh, thinking of Gargantua. Ha ha, a little milksop, he said. My big, big boy, so happy, so giggly, so handsome. Oh, how comforted is my heart. Let's drink. Let's forget sadness, bring out the best wine, rinse the glasses, spread the tablecloth, kick out the dogs, build up the fire, light up the candles, dole out the soup, close up the front door, send away the dogs, send away these beggars, hand them whatever they want, and bring me my embroidered robe. I want to look my best to entertain the ladies. As he said this, he heard the ritual chants of the priests putting his wife into the ground. He cut off his merry speech and cried out, Lord, I must grieve on and on. I'm not young anymore. The weather is bad. I might be coming down with some kind of fever. By my faith as a gentleman, it's better to cry less and drink more. My wife is dead, dead. Oh God, my tears won't bring her back to life. She's surely in paradise, unless there's someplace better. She prays for us, she's well, she's happy. My dear wife doesn't need to bother with all our miseries. I better think of finding myself another wife. Like all good little Christians, Gargantua was brought to the font and baptized. He passed his time in three ways: food, sleep, and drink. Sleep, drink, and food. Drink, food, and sleep. And after 1,400 flagons of wine and 9 jugs of milk a day, the little giant Gargantua had a fat, jolly face adorned by no fewer than 18 chins. One of his nurses often swore that at the very sound of the bottles clinking, he was in ecstasy, as if he tasted the joys of paradise, bobbing his head and grinning at the bottle. And when she dinged the glasses with a knife, the pints with their stoppers, little Gargantua rocked himself, strumming with his fingers and baritoning with his little bottom. How wonderful it was to hear him. But when he roused himself and got up, dear people, then he fell into the mud. He muddled his nose in it. He fished for frogs. He ran after butterflies. He used his sleeve for a hanky. He dropped boogers into his soup. He pissed in his shoes. He drank from his shoe. He washed his hands in his stew. And for laughs, he tickled himself. His father's little dogs ate from his dishes, and Gargantua ate with them. He nibbled their ears. They scratched his nose. He played at hand snatting, at snorting, at farting, at pirouetting, at ferreting, at toadying, at captaining, at seesawing, at blind man's bluff, at bum trumpeting, at ripping the feet off the little flies and pulling the birdies out of their nests. He had a lovely hobby horse, and he made it charge, jump, prance, and smash into everything. Meanwhile, Mr. Appetite arrived. Then he'd barrel through the women running to the kitchen to know what was roasting on the spit. Theologically thirsty, Gargantua would get stewed on 11 or 12 jugs of wine. Before long, he was bellowing like a whole troop of devils. Stentor's voice at the Battle of Troy was nothing compared to Gargantua's. And all this while, Gargantua thrived and grew day by day. His intelligence was sharp and subtle. Sharp and subtle, as if he'd been touched by some divinity. So, to get the highest academic degree in science, he was sent to Paris, to the Sorbonne. He carried a satchel as heavy as 7,000 tons, and he studied under the guidance of Flumix Alsifu Holofernes, Theoreticus Bride, Jean-Jacques Gerardopoulos, and other coughing, toothless old scholars, cunning marketeers of outlandishness, and abstractors of quintessences. He studied the works of Donat, Fassé, Darindou, Alanus, Paraobulis, with commentary by Merd Buff, Biggersau, Deutschbubler, and stacks of others. This course of study took him 18 years, 11 months, and 14 days. Then he entangled himself in learning the lives of saints, Saint Foutin the farsighted, Saint Immaculata the nose dripping, and Saint Canard, who was martyred by cooked potatoes at the seat of Toulouse. Gargantua knew all this material so well he could recite it backwards and forwards at the whims of those eminent scholars. He spent 24 years, 4 months, and 3 days studying it. So finally, they made him a provostial coprophage in the Simian Academy. He was an enhanced junior fellow of the Hephalumpian Society, a full and engorged professor of priestly bagpipery, a third degree laureate of the Flatulential Order of the Presidential Ratatouille, an impactful muzzler of dames, and a dean's figment of innovative leadership and celestial worth. In spite of all these studies, nevertheless, Gargantua graduated as a dreamy nitwit. Biased, limp, dim, feeble, slow, spoiled, lethargic, dazed. The type who spouts nothing. Nothing but dead donkey farts. One morning, Gargantua received the following letter from his father, Grangousier. Dear son, the fervor you have given to your studies would make me hesitate to disturb such philosophic undertakings. Were it not that, a friend, an ancient ally whom I completely trusted because of a mysterious affair between our peoples, he has declared war against us. Our intention was not to attack him, but make peace, to keep our faithful subjects and hereditary lands, which this Piquer Shoal has just invaded, where day after day he pursues his furious plans to such degree as cannot be tolerated by free men. I sent Piquer Shoal a friendly note inquiring what or who had provoked his rage, but all I got in response was his declaration of war. So, dear son, as soon as you have your Sorbonne degree, come quickly to rescue us. The peace of God be upon you, my dearest child. The 20th of September, your father, Grand Goussier. At the same time, Piquer Shoal was holed up in the stronghold of Roche-Clermault, where his helpers, the Duke de Fleck-Drabble, Lord General Buckleswash, Commodore Schittel, and other nasty bits of brass came before him, and they said, "Sire, today we proclaim you the Emperor of the greatest conqueror there ever was since Alexander the Great." "Oh, come," said Piquer Shoal. "Sire, here is what we propose. You will leave some captain garrisoned here to guard this fort. Your army will divide into two. The first part of the army will smash into Onisse and the Saintonge, Gascony, and the lands that it can take with the least resistance. At Fontarby, you'll seize all the battleships and, outflanking Portugal, pillage all the ports between here and Lisbon, where you'll find the reinforcements you need to continue your conquests." "Jove's tit. Spain will be at your mercy, since they're a bunch of nincompoops." "You'll pass Gibraltar. There you will erect two columns, both lovelier than that of Hercules, to perpetuate the memory of your name. The strait will be renamed the Piquer Shoalian Sea. Passing through the Piquer Shoalian Sea, the Barbars, the Balearics, and all the islands of the Gulf of Genoa. Once we have taken Narbonish Gaul, Provence, Lucca, and Florence from behind, you, sire, will enter Rome. That pathetic little monsieur, the Pope, is already trembling with terror. Once Italy is done with, we'll take Cyprus, Rhodes, and the Cyclades. Then, after they surrender, we'll move on to the Peloponnese. We'll capture it, and then... Then, God save Jerusalem. "I don't want anything bad to happen to Jerusalem," Piquer Shoal assured them. "Quite the opposite. I'll have the temple rebuilt. It'll be 100 times more magnificent than Chambord or Chantilly, and in the seven-armed chandelier there, I will enclose one of King Solomon's real hairs." But wait, said Commodore Schüttel. Don't be so hasty in your plans. That will be for the return journey. First, sire, we must take Asia Minor and all the countries on this side of the Euphrates. We'll take care of everything. But what will we drink in those deserts? We'll take care of all that. 9,014 battleships full of the best wine in the world will arrive in Jaffa, to be met there by 20,000 camels and 1,615 elephants. Crossing the two Armenias and the three Arabias, they will arrive at our camp. Now, sire, won't we have enough wine? But we'll have to drink it warm. Sire, a knight in shining armor, a conqueror pursuing the throne of the universal empire, can't always have his luxuries. Give grace to God that you and yours will arrive sound in mind and body at the Tigris. But, said Picrochal, what will the other part of our army be doing in the meantime?
They won't sit on their heels.
Once they crush the army of that shameless old drunk, Grand Goussier, they'll have conquered Brittany, Normandy, Flanders, Burgundy, and Lyon for you, and there you'll find your garrisons when you return from your naval conquests in the Mediterranean. Passing the Rhine, they will sack Germany, Austria, Poland, Russia, Wallachia, Turkey, and enter Constantinople. They'll have the Sultan quivering in his breeches like a suppository.
Then I'll be Emperor of Trebizond. Come, come, sire, raise your armies. Flecktrabble, we give you Carmenia, Syria, and all of Palestine.
Ah, sire, great thanks.
And your lordship, General Buckleswash, we give you Hungary and Transylvania.
Ah, sire, may God keep you prosperous forever.
And Commodore Schüttel, we give you Bavaria.
Ah, sire, we all wish to live and die under your rule. There was one old, battle-hardened general at this meeting who declared, I'm afraid this might end like the farce of the milk jug, where the little girl with a big imagination breaks the pot and has nothing left for supper. But they all called him a worm-eaten old hypocrite, and Picrochal cried, I bite, I smash, I whack, I crash, I kill, I crow. Down with the enemy, and all those who love me, follow me. Thank you. Picrochol's advanced troops did arrive before the wall of the Abbey Suillet, and they entered the monastery grounds. It was just the beginning of autumn, the pretty harvest season. The sun was high and clear. The air was cool. All of nature delighted the eye. The Picrocholian flag bearers laid their plumed helmets down along the wall. The buglers filled their bugles with grapevines. The drummers kicked in one side of their drums to fill them with clusters of grapes. Each one went about his business quietly as he could. The monks, unaware of their misfortune, were in the chapel, where they sang in the following manner.
Oh, asparagus me, domine, pisopo, et mundaber, super, vente al abore.
But one true monk, if there ever was one since the monkish realm first monked monkery, Brother Jean of the Broadfeets, young, alert, gallant, strong, and tough, he glanced through a faulty bit of stained glass and he saw Picrochol's soldiers enjoying their horrific harvest. "Aye, good fathers," he cried, still using his singing voice. "Goodbye, basket, the harvest's going. This coming year, we'll have nothing but vinegar to drink." Right away, he stripped off his robe. He grabbed the stem of the cross, which was pure serviceberry wood, and without any warning, he fell on his enemies, swinging his arms. They thought they were dealing with all the devils in hell. He squashed the skulls of many. He ripped off the arms and legs of others. He flattened noses. He broke eyes. He broke jaws. He punched belly buttons so hard that guts came out. It was a beautiful sight. Some died without a word. Others talked without dying, shouting, "Miserere, confiteor." Almost all who entered the fields were overcome by Jean's prowess. Some 13,622 by number, not counting women and children. By some misfortune, a few enemies turned back, and seeing that one humble monk had single-handedly managed this battle, they rushed him and took him prisoner. At the same time, Gargantua hurried to his father's aid as fast as his horse could carry him. Grand Goussier's men cheered at the return of Gargantua. With the military tactics of his chiefs and the money of the good king, the army ran like clockwork. Count Jump the Gun led the forward guard. Lieutenant Stolitzais led the infantry. General Brokefire commanded the cavalry. The rear guard was trusted to the care of the celebrated Colonel Narrow Buttocks. Gargantua, whose exploits surpassed those of Themistocles, Scipio, Africanus, and Julius Caesar all put together, took charge of the army as a whole. He declared that they would march on the fortress of Rochemont as light fell to surprise Picrochol. When evening came, Gargantua stood proud and tall and ordered, "Forward, march!" They marched in such good order, you would have said they were the children of Israel, leaving Egypt through the Red Sea. But as they neared Rosh Klimo, the army was caught in a heavy rain. Right away, Gargantua cried, "Halt, I command you." And so, gathering all his people in front of him, Gargantua got down on his knees and he began to stick out his tongue, bit by bit, covering them with his tongue like a mother hen covers her chicks so well you could wander around underneath it like you can in Notre Dame in Paris or at Hagia Sophia in Constantinople. And now, you cataracts of the air, thunder all you like. Gargantua's soldiers will laugh. Nice and dry and warm, they dreamed of noble exploits. The rain had stopped by daybreak when the lookouts from Rosh Chamo signaled their arrival. As they contemplated Gargantua's terrifying stature, which allowed him to see well above the clouds, it occurred to Duke Flickdrabble and to his lordship General Buckleswash that perhaps conquering the world might not be as simple as they had at first imagined. They decided it would be prudent for them to discreetly fall back on positions they had prepared in advance, leaving the honor of defending the fortress to their flock. Only Commander Schittel stayed by Picrochol's side. He was, to tell the truth, of no more than middling intelligence, but he was nevertheless an excellent soldier. He raised the alarm, and he aimed his artillery at Gargantua, and he commanded Satan's greetings from his cannon. After that thunder of cannon passed, Gargantua thought he felt some kind of vermin scrabbling in his hair. At first, he thought it must be a couple of lice that he had picked up at the Sorbonne. But when he shook his head, 40,783 cannonballs fell out, almost crushing a little ecclesiastical flea who ran beside him. That was Brother Jean, who had managed to escape. That got up his spirits, since there'd been so little wine in prison that the spiders made webs in his teeth. Meanwhile, Commander Schittel reloaded, preparing to fire his cannon at Gargantua a second time. The kind of driven, military steadfastness that is good only for arms dealers and blunderbuss salesmen, Commodore Schittel certainly would have ordered a third attack, but Gargantua decided to put an end to the whole business. He was annoyed by these prickles that irritated him like a hail of grapeseed. Gargantua tore an enormous oak tree from the ground and fashioned it into a club, and continued his advance on Rochefort. He set out to demolish the towers, crash the turrets, crush the wall walks, rip out ramparts, shatter the murder holes, fracture the barbican, and dismember the drawbridge. To finish his masterwork, Gargantua inundated his enemies with such a mighty shower of piss that they all drowned. Except for Pique Rochol, who, drenched and furious, fled on the back of an old donkey, and the donkey wasn't sticking around either. In memory of this great victory, the noble Grand Goussier ordered an abbey built on the site of Rochefort. And he wanted to appoint Brother Jean to be the abbot to honor the first man to fight Pique Rochol. But Brother Jean replied at once, he did not wish to be charged with the care and keeping of monks. How could he govern others without knowing how to govern himself? Nonetheless, Grand Goussier convinced Brother Jean that he could run the abbey any way that he saw fit. And so, by the side of the harmonious River Loire, near a great forest, this famous abbey was founded, the Abbey of Thelème, which so many still speak of. For its construction and appointment, Gargantua supplied 669,000 pieces of gold. The magnificent building was in the form of a hexagon, with a large round tower at each corner. The light poured in, rippling over the porphyry, the chalcedony, and the serpentine marble. Each floor was divided into the languages of its books in Latin, Greek, Hebrew, Etruscan, and French. Brother Jean only admitted beautiful, well-proportioned women and handsome, well-muscled men. And instead of having to stay for life, each one could come and go as he pleased. Instead of living in chastity and obedience, they could be married, wealthy, and free. There There were no clocks, calendars, or sundials in this tranquil utopia. They weren't ruled by the sound of the bell, but by the voices of good sense and love and reason. And because well-born, well-taught people, when they converse in honest company, have by nature an instinct that pushes them toward virtue and distances them from vice, there was only one rule in the Abbey. Do what you want. And Pique Rochelle, you may ask. What happened to him? He became a meat pie seller and a hawker of green sauce. In the evening, at his fireside, when he darned his socks, Pique Rochelle dreamed of taking back the empire that an old prophetess had promised would be his at the second coming of the cockroaches. And thanks to a little pension that the benevolent Gargantua gave him, in secret, Pique Rochelle lived well enough. Except for the occasional beatings that he got from his wife. And that's how Pique Rochelle was remembered in folk ballads throughout the land. And ever since, people claim that in France, everything ends with songs.